Our gospel reading today comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 13, verses 24 to 37. But in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory, and he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, and from the ends of the earth and the ends of heaven. From the fig tree learn its lesson. As soon as its branches become tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, truly I tell you that he is near at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about the day and the hour no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be aware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with their work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight, or at cock crow or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you all, keep awake. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
Please be seated. So once December hits, we usually have a pretty standard playlist in most of our heads, right? We had it on yesterday when we were decorating the Pandora Christmas, list, and it's beginning to look like Christmas. All those wonderful songs. All those happy songs. I gotta confess, I do not have songs about Christmas trees and Santa running through my head as I prepare for this sermon. Instead, the song running through my head all week long was from The Lion King. And it was Scar and the Hyenas, and it was them saying, "Be prepared!" It's not a happy song. And our text today might not seem like happy texts, but there's something happening, something that's important, and it's okay if you're not quite at Christmas yet, because guess what? It's not Christmas yet. It's Advent. Advent is a fabulous time in the church year. There are four Sundays in Advent, all right? And while one of them is on Christmas Eve, yes, Advent is a great time to challenge yourself to come to church every Sunday for a season of the church year. One, because it's like the shortest season of the church year. So if you're going to do any of them, that's a good one to start with. And two, because Advent builds towards the coming of Christ. Advent is when we long for and hope and watch and prepare. And it's a season of anticipation. And anticipating not just what has happened already with the birth of Jesus Christ. When we say we are anticipating the coming of Christ, Lutherans, as always, we can't just mean one thing when we say something. So we've got to mean two things at least. And they have to be two things that usually contradict each other, throw into the question the very laws of physics and nature and the reality of life as we know it. Yay! Advent is when we anticipate the coming of Christ. And that means we build towards Christmas, when we have celebrated what has already happened, But it is also when we build towards the second coming of Christ. The coming of Christ that we proclaim and confess to believe each Sunday in our creed when we say, Christ will come again to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. Now I'm going to be real honest. Lutherans don't talk a lot about the second coming. It's a topic that we tend to get a little squirmy about inside, and when we look at apocalyptic, this text in Mark is actually what's known as the little apocalypse. An apocalypse, as Pastor Dave was saying last week, an apocalyptic literature is something that reveals the end. It is an unveiling of God and an unveiling of God into our reality. So we tend to think about apocalypse, and we tend to think about Isaiah. We tend to think about people saying, you know, they got back from exile and the temple wasn't rebuilt and the glory wasn't restored and life was really hard and things weren't going their way. And they said, oh, that the mountains would come down. Oh, Lord, that you would rend the heavens and shake the mountains. And God, that you would prove to everyone that we are right. Oh, God, that you would come out with power and glory and majesty so we can all say to everybody, meter, meter, meter. We were right, we were wrong. We think about apocalypse as God coming and judging us. We think about it as something truly frightening, and in some ways it is. The end strips away any illusions that we are in control. It deprives us and wakes us up from the idea and the imaginary idea that we have any power or grandeur to save ourselves. It strips us of the identity and the status that we have accumulated in the world through wealth and privilege and power, and confronts us with the reality of what truly matters as God's kingdom. And that can be frightening. But it is more than just goats and sheep. It is more than just God coming to reward the righteous and punish the wrongdoers. It can't be that simple, because we're not that simple creature. We are neither goat nor sheep. Pastor Dave pointed that out beautifully last week. We're both. And God, in God's judgment and mercy, knows that. In Mark, the little apocalypse paints a very different picture of what that second coming will look like. It talks about how there will be suffering and struggling and wars. Not to say that, you know, things are going to get worse before they get better, but to say that God will come into the world as it is. There have always been wars and injustice and struggles and famine. And every generation says, it's worse now than it's ever been in the past. And that's true for you, because you didn't live through the past. And the future generations will probably say, yeah, it was bad back then, but boy, this seems worse. And people will point out and say, it's a sign that God is coming. Jesus reminds us that nobody knows when God is coming. That while we can look for the shoots on the tree to turn green, and anticipate and watch, we don't know. But we are called to be mindful. We are called to see that God truly is coming into the midst of the chaos and terror in our world. And not coming as a harsh judge who will punish, but coming as one who gathers. Coming as one who calls together and reconciles and heals. Our Mark text says that God's angels will come and gather his people from the four winds, from the four corners of the earth, and from the corners of heaven. It's not an illustration of a God who divides and segregates and says, you're right and you're wrong, you're in, you're out. But it's a God who calls with open arms and says, come. It is not an end of wars and terror, but rather an end to wars and terror. It is healing on a level that we have never experienced in our life. It is God making his world whole. And that is what we are called to be awake and watchful. We are called to anticipate this, not to just hope and pray that God will bring healing to the world, but to expect, anticipate, watch for, and work towards God's healing. This is not something we hope will happen. This is something we know will happen. When we read about bombings and shootings, about famines and war, when we experience the frustration of injustice and inequality between races, classes, genders, when we struggle with how we are going to share God's love in a world that doesn't look the way the world looked 25 years ago. And when we wonder, we are called to do so with a sure and certain hope that Christ is coming, that Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, is here and is coming. I know. Is here and is coming. Once again, Lutheran concepts, challenging the fabric of reality since 1517. Oh, come on, that was kind of clever. Thank you. I can pull that number out of my head. I'm not even awake yet. We are called to build and anticipate and watch and be awake. And being awake means that we are alive in this hope. It means our lives are shaped by it. It means we watch for the end, not so that we can be right and others can be wrong. Not an end of fire and fearfulness, but a still coming of God, a gathering in, a healing of hearts and souls and relationships. We are called to be awake in this time in between what has happened and what will happen, and live our lives in that reality, the reality of hope, the reality that there is something more than the status of the world, the reality that we can pursue something beyond building our own lives. The reality that Christ is coming. I wish you a happy Advent. I invite you to enter into that reality. The hope that calls us to cry, come thou long expected Jesus. The longing that makes all mortal flesh be silent. And the peace of the Father's love begotten. Because this is Advent, and we are.